Hello everyone, thank you very much for joining me again. This episode 12 of the Software Architecture Fundamentals stream, where we continue the discussion on security. And today we start with the authentication and authorization subjects, which are very important. They represent the backbone of what we call application level security. So whenever someone says application level security, most likely they refer to either authentication or authorization. So this is why our today's subject is a very important one. It's very relevant and is something you should know. Some parts of it, I would say, even as a user of your applications, not necessarily as a developer. If you are watching the event live, don't forget that you have a live chat there, so you can ask me questions in the live chat directly or start discussions if you want. If you are watching the event recorded, you can still ask questions in the comment section and I will try to answer you in one of the next videos or in a comment as well. With that being said, let's continue our discussion with authentication and authorization by defining first these terms and telling you what you should know upfront about this. So the two A's is authentication and authorization. And of course, what you need to know is that authentication is the process in which your system or application identifies who tries to use a specific use case. So it's the way in which the system tries to see who is the one trying to call and use a specific function, endpoint. I say use case in general because we don't necessarily refer only to HTTP here, even though in a lot of cases, of course, REST endpoints and web services in general are affected a lot by authentication. But authentication is a much generic term, and whenever someone says authentication, it refers to the application identifying the caller. So, and that is whatever way, whatever mean of identifying the caller. No, I didn't change the drawing software. I just took a note because I don't really like the way it looks like in Inkscape. So I still have Inkscape here, but it's a little bit more difficult, I find it, to write in Inkscape. So I said I will try this time to use notes. Let's see how it works. If it doesn't work well, then I will go back to the Inkscape. So authentication, I would say, so this is the app identifying the caller of a specific use case, whatever the means to call the use case is. And there are different ways, theoretically, in a large amount of cases, when someone refers to authentication, they often make confusion with simply using a username or a password, so what we call a login. And while in most cases logging into an app with a username or a password is authentication, well, authentication is not necessarily only using credentials like username and password. So first of all, just try to think at a more general level and remember that authentication is any means by in which the application identifies the user. So it can simply be a fingerprint. When for a couple of years already, when I go to the supermarket here, there is a service that identifies, you can use to identify yourself and pay with your fingerprint. So that's still authentication. First of all, whatever means you choose to identify yourself, if it's a username and a password, if it's a code sent through an SMS message on your phone, if it's your fingerprint, if it's a key, it can be something hardware that you use to plug into your computer to identify. Any this kind of means is authentication. It's just you showing who you are so that the application recognizes you. And then based on who you are, you will be authorized. Authorization being the process that follows the authentication. And in the authorization, once the application in any means found out who you are, you will get or not some specific privileges. These privileges being what are you allowed to do. So you might want to call a specific use case, say X, you authenticate yourself, but the application might say you are not allowed to do this, you are not allowed to call this specific use case X. And that privilege offering based on who you are is what we call authorization. So the app gives you or not certain privileges, and that's what we call authorization. So basically it's very easy, but at the same time it's very important. Now we know what authentication is and we know what authorization is. So authentication is, this is who I am, and authorization is when the app says you are allowed to do this or that. So you are or you aren't allowed to do something. The app authenticates you, finds out who you are, and then it authorizes you, telling you that you are or not allowed to do something. So it sounds very simple, but there are plenty of ways in which you can authenticate. So there is no definition for an authentication implementation. We know different styles which we use as users or have we have implemented as developers, but depending on what you want to do, you find plenty of different scenarios in which you can authenticate your users. So you can use credentials, as I said, username and password. You can have, for example, a specific key. That key can be hardware or software. You can have your fingerprint use. You can use your face, like you do in case of an eye device, you authenticate with your face. You turn your mobile phone and the mobile phone recognizes your face. That's still authentication. So any kind of this implementation in the end has only one purpose, identifying who you are. If the authentication fails, it means that the application didn't manage to recognize you, and in that case the authorization will not even happen. If the application finds out who you are, then the next step is authorization, where the app will basically tell you what you are allowed or not allowed to do. So if you call a specific use case and you are not allowed, then you will not be able to call it just because the app doesn't allow you to do so, because you are not authorized, you don't have the privilege. Based on who you are, you don't have the privilege to do that specific use case. So that's the whole idea. Now I would like to go to a Postman, because this is a tool that we very often use to call endpoints, and in general in applications, again, authentication is not only about endpoints, but it's a good way for me, for example, to present it now as an example. And let's take a simple case. Suppose you have an application that exposes REST endpoints. To call those endpoints that give access to specific use cases, you need to authenticate and eventually get authorized. If your application would be implemented in the Java ecosystem with Spring, then most likely you would use Spring Security to implement it. But let's stick and discuss generally these subjects, so that again, even if usually I will give you examples from the Java ecosystem because I'm a Java developer, those things that I discuss in this stream, in the software architecture fundamental stream, they are applicable with any technology. So I don't want you to understand that it's only something that is Java related. So whatever technology behind the scenes you would use to implement your endpoints, you would see in Postman that one of the tabs you have here is authorization. So this is basically a little bit confusing, because this tab authorization, it's not only about authorization, it's both about the authentication and the authorization. And if you go, you will see it has this nice combo box here that allows you to go through different ways of both authenticating and then getting authorized. So you see here, for example, no auth, it means no authentication. So in case I choose this, I choose to call the endpoint without having any mechanism for authentication. If I have a plain endpoint, if I have my application simply exposes a plain endpoint that doesn't have any authentication, then of course I will be able to call the endpoint. I won't be neither authenticated and nor authorized by my application since I have chosen this and since my implementation doesn't imply any security restrictions. But there are also different other ways down below, and we will discuss now some of the most important and most often used. When I say important, generally I refer to most often used in applications, because you can't really measure importance in terms of specific techniques for authenticating and authorizing in applications. But you can say that, for example, very often today, if you are in a service-oriented architecture, then we use OAuth 2.0 for our authorization implementation, so as a framework specification. So that's something we can say, and that's why I could say OAuth 2 is important, because it's very often today used and we want to discuss it and you want to know it and understand it pretty well, because I bet that any technology you will use to implement your apps, there is a great chance that you will have to implement authentication and authorization of using the OAuth 2 framework. So that's why I say important. Now, let's start with the easiest one. So the easiest one is an API key. This is what we also call a static key. The API key is simply a static key that is used to access the endpoint. So it is one of the weakest mechanisms for authentication. So it's very, very important. Authentication is also part of this, even if the tab is called authorization, because the API key helps first someone to authenticate against against an application calling a specific endpoint, and then of course it will afterwards be authorized as well, because the API key basically will identify a specific user, and that user might have some specific privileges assigned to them, so they will be granted those privileges that are assigned to that user. So the API key, if I select it, you will basically see that I only need to add this value to a specific header or query parameter, because in some cases the API key is used as a query parameter. But the idea is it's only a short identifier that someone gives me, and I have to keep it secret, and I use it to authenticate against some specific endpoint. So basically, it's, again, as I said, one of the weakest way to authenticate, because it's only like a password, like a secret you use, and you put on the endpoint to get authenticated and then eventually authorized to call a specific endpoint. And very often API keys are used, and I would suggest you only use them when implementing authentication between two backend components. So never use an API key to implement authentication from a frontend to a backend component. Usually this should only be in case of two components communicating in the same data center, and preferably in an infrastructure that doesn't imply the communication going outside of the data center. So now, because I know you're missing my Inkscape, like you said earlier, I'm going to the Inkscape because this is where I can draw something. And imagine this is the data center. The data center is nothing than, say, the group of computers that you structure as your hardware infrastructure and your networking. You implement the networking in between them so that you execute there your backend. And if you have two services that communicate, and they all always communicate inside the same data center, and mind, this is might be tricky, and I will explain you this in even more details when we get to cloud deployments, because you will learn that it's actually possible that depending on how you implement, how you orchestrate your infrastructure, even if you might consider that your components are inside the same place, they might not be, because you might have multiple what we call availability zones. And the availability zones, they are different regions. A bad word, it's not the correct word, the region to use, because we also have geographical regions. So it's maybe better to say places. The availability zones are different places far enough away one from the other, so that if one of the availability zones fails because of a certain event, like an earthquake or floods or something like that, then you know for sure, or pretty sure, that another availability zone will not be affected by the same event. But I will get into more details about that when we discuss about clouds. I don't want you to bother with that now. But just now, to go back to our static API key. So you use the static API key only when you have two applications, these two squares, rectangles, whatever they are here, they are two components, two services, and they, that's very important, they are inside the same data center, so the communication doesn't go outside. So even though I actually consider this rule to be very important, mind that I see it very often misused in practice. So I see, basically, it was a couple of weeks ago, last time, when someone, a collaborator of one of the applications I'm consulting now, we need to call some endpoints on their side. And when I asked about authentication, and I was expecting they use OAuth 2, which is basically what I would have recommended, and they told me they are using basically static API keys, which is pretty bad, because they are outside our organization, which means that when we call them, I can't tell you names, who they are and so on. That wouldn't be correct from my side. But it's this kind of a public service that you call, and instead of having a proper way to authenticate, to simply have a static key, which is not really okay when you communicate over the public network. So you can use static keys, but my recommendation is, if you choose this kind of authentication, say in your case app 1 needs to call app 2, they are inside the same data center, you basically should know, of course, the way you orchestrate your apps and how they communicate always. And then in that case, you can use a static key for authentication. But otherwise, if your traffic goes outside in the public network, then my recommendation is to avoid this kind of an authentication, and use, say, a stronger authentication approach than this one. And the stronger authentication approach, say a stronger authentication approach, now we have multiple choices that we will discuss, but in case of a backend, you have the possibility of using OAuth 2, but you also have the possibility to implement something more simpler. So if you want to go a step further and say I want to have two backend applications communicating one to the other, but I don't want to use a static API key for that, what you can do, you can use a signature with public private keys, as we discussed in the previous episode. So remember, in the previous episode we discussed about encoding, encryption and signing, and we discussed about what it means to encrypt with a symmetric and asymmetric key pair, or assigning a message with symmetric or asymmetric key pair. So I do rely on the fact that you now understand those concepts. I won't have the time to repeat them in each and every lesson, but in case you didn't see that episode and you don't understand how encryption and signature works with symmetric and asymmetric keys, then I do recommend you go to that episode 11 where I discuss that, And again, if you still have questions, of course, don't hesitate to ask me in the comment section or in the chat during one of our lessons. One of the other possibilities is, as we discussed in the previous episode, that app 1 signs the message and then app 2 verifies the signature. And in case you use an asymmetric key pair, then you will always have the private key only on the side that sends the message and signs the message. So because the signature, remember what we discussed, is done with the private key, and then the public key will be used to verify that the message continues to be integer and that someone didn't change it in between. So and that again is still a way of authenticating in this case, because what we want to do when we have two applications communicating one to the other, the authentication is simply a way in which you want to make sure that you receive you receive the message from that specific application and not from someone else. So you want to make sure that there is no one who impersonated app 1 and is calling app 2 on behalf of app 1. If you use a digital signature, as we discussed, with a public-private key pair, with an asymmetric key pair approach, then you not only make sure that the app 2 that receives the message is sure that app 1 was the one sending it, because app 1 is the only one knowing the private key, so it's impossible to be someone else. But above the static key, the one that we started with, that's only a way, only a secret that identifies the message, that again is used for app 2 to know that app 1 sent it to the message. When you use a digital signature, this much stronger approach, you also make sure that no one changed the message, because if they would have changed the message, then the signature doesn't comply anymore. So app 2 now doesn't only use the signature on the message to know that and to be certain that app 1 was the sender, but it can also validate that the message wasn't changed in between, so while it was on the move or in transition, as we learned this is called in the previous couple of lessons. So to summarize what I discussed up to now, my recommendation is, in case you have the communication in between two components of the backend, even here avoid using static keys and use something that is a bit stronger. Now maybe you are asking, okay, but what's the disadvantage, because otherwise we wouldn't use static keys anymore. So isn't there any case where a static key is better than, say, having alternative that is much stronger? Of course, the alternative that is much stronger, like using a signature, also implies some more work for the application sending the message as well as for the application consuming the message, because now you have to sign it using a cryptographic algorithm, and then on the other side you have to validate it using a cryptographic algorithm. So that means performance in this case will be affected. But remember what we discuss and what I always say about software architecture is that this field is nothing, I would say sometimes nothing more than the art of making compromises between software qualities, between non-functional software qualities such as security and performance. So what do you want? You want more security or you want more performance? You want more performance or you want your app to be more maintainable, easier to maintain? And that's always compromises between them. And the whole idea is that you will never have all of them at the top high. It's always a compromise between the software qualities. And that's the art of being a software architect in the end. So yes, what happens is that if you use a static key, then it's only a comparison on the other side. This one is only adding a header, and the app 2 is only comparing a header, which means that the performance is very high because the operation is less complex. If you use a signature, then of course your security gets higher because now it's much more difficult to if you don't have the private key, you cannot replicate the signature. It's also impossible to modify the message while in transition, so it's clearly more secure. But it implies that App 1 has to use a cryptographic algorithm to sign the message every time. App 2 has to do the same thing to validate the message, which costs from the performance of the app. So it's not that when I say don't use the API key approach for authentication when the communication is public, I say that because being public, someone can really get in behind and steal that, and then they get access to whatever to whatever you are exposing. So it's a higher risk when the communication is public than when the communication is in the same data center. So that's why I said, in my opinion, we shouldn't use static API keys when outside of the data center, because the risk is very high for someone to steal it. But if we are inside, then the risk becomes much, much smaller. So using a static key, an API key, can be a better option in terms of rising your performance by taking out of the security, because you know that being inside the data center, you anyway rely on some certain security that comes out of the infrastructure. So, but again, you really have to understand, know how your application works, where it is deployed, how it is deployed, how is it orchestrated if necessary, how it executes, how many instances of the same application are there, where are they executed, and so on. All these aspects give you the feeling of security versus non-security, and will influence your choices whether you want to be less secure in your communication using static API keys, or you want to go a little bit since one step further and make the compromise of having a more secure communication than having and having, of course, a less performant application that now will have to work a bit more for sending every message. So you see, this is the compromise. This is how you need to think. But in case I'm going in a communication in between two applications on the public space, then I would definitely avoid using the static keys. So now if I maybe complete here my diagram, I would say just have an app 3 here outside of the data center. So just that just means executed somewhere else. Don't know why my Inkscape works so poorly on the Mac, but I think it does its job still. So let's say we have this app 3 here, and it's communicating with app 2. And the communication is done via the public network. So imagine that the big rectangle is my data center. So if app 2 is outside the data center, it means the communication now goes public. And of course, there are still ways to secure that. We maybe use VPNs, but still, once it's going outside, so here I maybe could use an API key. That could be a solution. But in between app 3 and app 2, I would simply use something that helps me sign the messages. So say maybe using a signature in this case. So something that makes me certain that is much more difficult to intercept a message and change it than simply an API key. Okay, that doesn't mean in the real world, again, as I started with, it simply happens that out there is a jungle, you know, in software, so you will always find different things. That doesn't mean they are good if they are like that, but with these lessons I try to at least help you ask yourself some questions, and you don't necessarily need to have the same opinion as myself, so maybe you think differently, that's good, but at least ask yourself, what is that compromise? If you have something like this, does it really make sense to use an API key here? Can someone really intercept it? What happens if it does? Maybe nothing happens. If it's not a big deal, then okay, you might want to improve the performance of your app, but if it's a big deal, then you need to find some better approach, like I was describing, using assigning the messages, as we also discussed in the previous episode. Now, going a little bit further, so API key, basic authentication. What is basic authentication? This is something that is very often used in a lot of examples. It's not something that you will very often see in real world apps, because, well, it's almost the same thing as using an API key, but you have a username and the password that you share through the endpoint, and I will tell you immediately how this happens. What about API secrets? Google and others are using client ID client secrets. So I'm going to that as well, Otto. Just let me take them one by one, because the client ID and client secret is basically related to OAuth 2.0. So I will discuss them when I get here. So, and I will get here just immediately, because after we discuss the basic oath, bearer token and OAuth 2.0 options here are related. So we will discuss them just after the basic oath. So I will tell you what basic authentication is, because you will find it in a lot of examples, and it's a pretty easy way to implement proof of concepts on the first hand. When you work, for example, you try to learn a framework such as Spring Security, comfortable is to use basic OAuth, because it's pretty simple and it allows you to focus on something else that you want to learn inside the framework. But in the end, basic authentication, or HTTP basic, the other way we name it, is still not a strong authentication mechanism. So what happens is simply that you have a username and the password, and this username and password, they are in fact just separated with a colon. See, it's just like that. So they are separated with a colon and then base64 encoded. And then the result of base64 encoding the user and the password is prefixed with basic. So we say basic and then the password and the username that have been base64 encoded. And that's basically it. So that's everything. And if you remember, we discussed about encodings in the previous couple of episodes. And you know that encoding, unlike encryption is a type of encoding, but encoding doesn't necessarily mean you encrypt something. Encoding is only, when we say encoding, we refer to any transformation. Base64 encoding is just a transformation. It doesn't secure anything. It just transform an input into an output from where you can go back to the input without having any secret and without knowing anything else. So if I have an endpoint here, I don't have any app on now running, but I don't think it really matters, because I think we will still see what Postman does with this. Let's see, if I made this request, what actually happened is that somewhere in the headers, see that Postman also had some headers that are hidden. If you don't see them, you have to actually click here and see the hidden headers. And you see that what actually happened is that Postman added this authorization header here. And exactly as I told you, you have the word basic space, and then this is a base64 encoding. This is exactly what I was telling you here. So you have the word basic, as a prefix, then you have a space, and then you have the base64 encoding of this user colon and then password. So that means that this might look for a beginner like an encryption, but it is not an encryption. If you simply just go to a browser, search base64 decode, paste it here, and decode, you will find the input back. So you see there is nothing secure here. So it's just, this is just an encoding. And again, I used as an example the base64 encoding, which is very often used in practice, also in the previous episodes. So what base64, what HTTP basic means, it's just in the authorization header, you have a username and a password separated with a colon and a base64 encoded, and then whoever receives this, the server that would receive it, would base64 decode it, separate the username and the password because they are always separated with a colon, and then use the username and the password. They are not encrypted. If you are using HTTPS, fine, that means they will rely on the encryption provided by HTTPS. If you are using HTTP, then you should, of course, you shouldn't use HTTP today, that's not the case, but in case you would use HTTP, then this is something that absolutely anyone could intercept and steal, because this is not an encryption. So mind that base64 is not encryption, it's encoding. Encoding in base64 can always from the output go to the input back. So you have to be very careful with that. Okay, so that's basically HTTP basic. So mind when you rely on HTTP basic, it's not something that you should often rely on. Anyway, it's not really something comfortable, at least in case of client backend communication. So if it's a client backend communication, that would actually mean that somehow the client would need to store some credentials and then reuse them on any endpoint, which is practically something that is not only vulnerable, but it's also I don't know how to say it, but unmaintainable, maybe it's a good word. You simply can't just send some credentials over the network again and again every time you call an endpoint. And neither when we discuss, in this case, communication between two apps in the same data center, you might say, okay, this could work here. And the fact is that indeed it could work here, but it's still, in most cases, much easier to use an API key instead of HTTP basic. Because anyway, the protection, let's say the level of protection you gain is the same, but you don't need to have a client and the password. An API key is only one piece of information, so you're relying on the API key in that case is better because it's simpler than using HTTP basic. So that's why you won't really see a lot HTTP basic used in apps. Because it doesn't neither fit on the, say, front and back end communication, neither it fits in two back end communications on the public network, and it doesn't fit, or it might fit, but you have easier solutions to implement that inside the same data center. Nevertheless, you need to understand the HTTP basic, because in most examples, again, when you learn something, it's pretty easy to use HTTP basic to simply say mock a more complex way of authenticating and focus on something else. And I always use that trick in my Spring Security lessons because it helps the student focus on what they have to learn and focus less on the authentication itself. So I only have to teach authentication once, and then I use, instead of having always a more complex way to authenticate in my examples, I use HTTP basic. Then no one has to focus anymore on authentication, and they focus on for example, authorization mechanisms or whatever I want to teach further. And I do recommend you do it like that as well. So yeah, that's it. And now, because I know you're curious, we should also discuss OAuth 2. And now, mind that OAuth 2, and also again related to what you see here as a bearer token, and I will explain how immediately, and most likely we will continue the discussion in the next episode, because it's kind of a big subject, this OAuth 2, and I really want to treat it in all the details possible. So I don't want to only spend 20 minutes on it, because I wouldn't have the time to explain all the important concepts, and I neither want this to be a top of the mountain lesson on OAuth 2, because this is a very important subject, being that OAuth 2 is so much today used in, and especially in, service oriented architectures and microservices in more particular. But before going further, OAuth 2 is usually referred to as an authorization framework. That's first of all, you generally won't find it as being referred to authentication, because in theory, OAuth 2 doesn't specify anything about how should you authenticate the user. So you can still choose to authenticate the user in any means, by its fingerprint, by user credentials, username and password, using any kind of key and so on. So OAuth 2 is a framework specification telling you how to apply authorization mostly for a specific for communication between two applications. But I usually refer to both authentication and authorization, simply because even if OAuth 2 doesn't tell you how to authenticate your user, authentication is still mandatory and is something that happens also in OAuth 2, because you cannot have authorization without having authentication prior to that. So that's why you might hear me referring to OAuth 2 as both authentication and authorization, even if in general we should only stick to authorization, because this specification framework refers to authorization. So just as a disclaimer, so that you know that it's not that I do that on purpose. It's not that I don't know what OAuth 2 is that I have my own way to view some things, because I think it makes the things easier to understand this way. And in the end, what your target is and what my target is understand the things that I do there. It's not recited from a specific article, book, or specification. That's what you need to get out of any lesson. It's a mental model of that specific mechanism that you are learning. And with that being said, so authentication and authorization. We already discussed that. I would like to tell one more thing, because I don't want to forget it. In terms of HTTP, you will find something very interesting, is that whenever authentication fails, usually a framework will give you back an HTTP response. Do you have any idea which would be, for authentication, the status code for this HTTP response? Any HTTP response has a status code, and usually when everything goes well, we have that 200 okay, or some of the 200 family, 201, 204, all of them means that things are fine. But when something is not fine, we either have a 4XX or a 5XX status. And that is, again, that's a very good answer. So it's actually a 401 for authentication. So we have a 401 or 403, these two statuses. You have to, it's very funny, because usually when it's authentication, you will have a 401. And when the problem is with the authorization, it will be a 403. And I will tell you immediately why this is so funny. Is because if you will read a message of what 401 means and what 403 means, 401 has the message unauthorized. And then if it is unauthorized, why do we have it for authentication? Well, it's pretty funny because 401, even if it's unauthorized, and basically that's because it's from the first specifications of HTTP, when there was no separation between authentication and authorization, it's only unauthorized, and 401 has this message that no one will basically change. But in applications today, when you will find the 401 back, usually is because of an authentication problem and not an authorization problem, even though the message is unauthorized. While 403, the name is forbidden. And this is basically what you will most often find when it's an authorization problem. So if someone managed to authenticate, they use some right credentials, they validate it somehow, and the application knows who they are, then they will be further authorized. But if they try to do something that they are not allowed to do, then the app will come back with a 403 forbidden, and usually not a 401. And the app will come back with a 401, usually if simply the credentials were wrong or the application doesn't know and cannot identify the caller. So mind, because this can be tricky, just because of course 401 unauthorized for everyone would lead to rather think about authorization than authentication. But in most cases in real world and in frameworks that implement application level security, such as ping security, you will find that unauthorized is used for authentication and forbidden is the one used for authorization. That's what I wanted to say. And now that we know all this and we know the difference between authentication and authorization, and we now know that authentication can be done in multiple ways, I think the most important thing we need to discuss further is start our discussion on OAuth2, because OAuth2 is, again, as I said, a specification framework for authorization. That is very often used today in service-oriented architectures. So this is something that you should understand, and you will find it implemented in basically all the possible platforms, technologies. You can do OAuth2 with Java, but you can do it with Python, you can do it with .NET. Part of it is helped by any cloud provider. It's very, very important knowing what OAuth2 is, and then extending OAuth2 with what OpenID Connect is, which we will also discuss, gives you a large gives you large opportunities for implementing it in any platform. So again, OAuth2 is a specification framework. OpenID Connect, that we will discuss afterwards, is a protocol that relies on OAuth2, so it's on top of OAuth2. But what is a specification framework for authorization? A specification framework means that it's simply a story telling you how should you implement the authentication and authorization in your system. But it doesn't implement it for you. OAuth2 is not an implementation. OAuth2 is only a document, a specification, telling you this is how you should do it. These are all the rules you have to consider when you implement authentication and authorization. And if you follow these rules, then you will gain some of the benefits that we will discuss with the way of implementing authentication and authorization using this framework. But OAuth2 is not an implementation. There are implementations for OAuth 2 in any platform. Java has its own and in different frameworks. .NET has its own, Python has its own, JavaScript has its own, and so on and so forth. So the implementations, you can have whatever implementations in whatever languages and whatever platforms you have for OAuth 2. But if they fulfill the specification, then they should all work the same. Because if they don't, so if they do something that's not as specified, then it simply means that they don't fulfill the OAuth 2, so you cannot call them OAuth 3 implementations. Someone asked me a week ago or some days ago, how can they change the grant types names in an OAuth 3 implementation with Spring Security? And I said, you will see that grant types are ways in which you get tokens. You don't have to, if you don't know that now, it's not a problem. But as an idea, that's something defined by the specification. So in the OAuth 2 specification, there is a section where it says these are the grant types that OAuth 2 defines. And they are authorization code, implicit, password, client credentials, and so on. If you implement something that uses a grant type that is not the one in the specification, then it means you don't implement OAuth 2. It's just a custom authentication and authorization that might be similar to OAuth 2, but it's not OAuth 2. So that you can say that you have an OAuth 2 implementation as long as your implementation fulfills the specification. Yes, so in this stream, I will not implement it with Spring Security and with nothing else. I will just discuss it from the theoretical point of view, and I will tell you basically what are the most important things that you need to know about OAuth 2, about OpenID Connect, but I will not implement them again. Indeed. So if you want to see me implementing with Spring Security OAuth 2, then I have plenty of other videos out there where you can find me doing so. And that's why in this stream, which is a software architecture stream and not a Spring Security stream, I will only tell you what OAuth 2 is. But I will tell you in detail, so I'm not sure it will only be an overview, so I will not implement it, but I would like to go through all the grant types and so on. If you have already seen that and you feel that it doesn't help you, then you can just join the next episode and you don't have to listen to me telling it again. But I'm definitely certain that there is a lot of you out there that might be interested in learning or refreshing their OAuth 2 knowledge. So let's have the stream as complete as possible and discuss in detail OAuth 2 and OpenID Connect, and not only from an overview, but without implementing it, because indeed you can find me implementing it in another stream on the same channel. Cool. So this is when you think about OAuth 2, is this specification framework, and it's not an implementation. What does this specification framework tell us? So first of all, one of the main, say, important things about OAuth 2 is that it separates the authentication and the authorization responsibilities. So when you had an application, like just a normal application with a client and the backend, so this is a frontend, I don't know, it can be an app or it can be something running in the browser, so it can be a web application or it can be a mobile application, it doesn't really matter. Then the backend here, would one of the things that would have to do is make sure it authenticates the requests, and after authenticating the requests, it also authorizes them. That's a simple front-end back-end communication. When it comes to OAuth 2, we have the authentication and the authorization responsibilities separated. And you will see that this is really important because it tells us that you can still have the same app. For example, you can still have the same app doing both of them. So you can have the same backend that takes both responsibilities, but by separating them by the means of the specification, then it allows you see these two responsibilities as being possible to be implemented by two different components of the system. So instead of having both the authentication and the authorization part in the same component, you can now have them separately. Mind that OAuth 2 doesn't tell you that these two responsibilities cannot be implemented by the same app. It refers to the fact that you have two different responsibilities, and of course it will be your decision if you want to put them inside the same application still, so you can still have a front-end backend and the backend will take both responsibilities, or you can separate them into two apps. But you will always, from the OAuth 2 point of view, see these responsibilities as being two separate responsibilities. As you will see, it brings you more value to separate them into services than putting them into the same service. And that's why I don't recommend, and I never recommended, putting both responsibilities in the same service. So I always recommend you separating them. Even though the specification doesn't force you to do so, my recommendation is to split the responsibilities into two apps instead of putting them all together. And the names of these two responsibilities are the authorization server, and then the second one is what we call the resource server. But the resource server is just simply the backend solution of your application from which we took out the authentication. And again, you can put them all together, but it's much comfortable to have it separated whenever you implement this in a service-oriented architecture, or more particularly a microservices one. You will find out that separating the authentication allows you easier replace it for if it's needed further, easier implement it and enhance it, and of course easier scale it again in case it's needed. So putting it aside and making it separate, it helps you in more ways when discussing architecturally wise from the components of your system point of view. Because you can have basically the same authorization server serving multiple resource servers. So now I can separate it theoretically in authorization server and resource server, but now if you enlarge a little bit your view, you can imagine that in the same system, in the same organizational system, in the same organization, you might have multiple applications and multiple services that can be totally different, like in terms of business responsibility. This one is a backend serving a mobile application doing something. This one can be a backend serving a web application doing something. But both of them might rely on the same service since we separated and we took it outside. So you see, you have a lot of advantages if you separate the authentication and make it in a centralized way, such that in your system, first of all, being independent, you can easily scale it, replace it, and even use it for multiple apps of the same organization. But now, let's focus on the specification. And I see we don't have plenty of time still, but I wanted just to make sure that I at least put these responsibilities here on the diagram, and then we will take them in detail in the next episode. So now you have the authorization server and the purpose, and this is what we call the client. So this one here is some application that needs to access the backend. And as you will see, it can actually be a different service. That's possible as well. We will discuss it in the next episode. But for the beginning, let's just think about it as a mobile application that needs to access endpoints on the backend side. To do so, first of all, the mobile application needs a way to get authorized to access the endpoints. And to get authorized in terms of OAuth 2, that is being done with what we call a token. And the token is nothing more than just a piece of information that can be identified by the resource server. And you will see this is basically like an access card that allows the client to open doors on the resource server side. But the client needs this token. Without this token, the client cannot access the resources on the resource server side. Resources meaning, in this case, endpoints the client wants to call. So how does the client obtain a token? Well, it obtains a token by calling the authorization server. So before the client can even go and access an endpoint, it first has to get the token. It gets the token from the authorization server, and then it uses the token to access the resources on the resource server. These are the two main parts, the two stories, epics, tomes, that you need to learn in OAuth 2. One of them is, how can the client get a token? And you will see that there are multiple ways in which the client can obtain a token. And we call these ways grant types. And the second tome we will discuss is how can the resource server make sure the token is valid, and how does the resource server uses in general the token to authorize the requests sent by the client. So two tomes: how to obtain a token and how is the token used. And that's basically what we need to discuss. Take them one by one, and most likely in the next couple of episodes probably we will discuss these two tomes, and you will see that there are multiple ways in which a client gets the token and there are multiple ways in which the resource server can use the token. And you will even see that there are more kinds of tokens. So because a lot of people hear about JWT tokens, and they somehow put an equal sign between token and JWT. While JWT is a token technology, not every token needs to be a JWT. And that's again one of the other things we will discuss. But that will have to be in the next episode, because we spent our time for today. Let's close it here and continue in the next episode with these two tomes of OAuth 2. Up to that point, thank you very much again for being here with me, and thank you very much for listening to this episode, and have an excellent time further for study. Cheers.